My best memory is one summer in 1993. I had just finished the high school. And so here I am with my family, and I had won the best scholarship that the country was giving. And so I was headed for a national university. And I wasn't going to pay tuition. Actually, every month I would get allowance. But there are things we didn't know. Number one, I didn't know I'd never see them again. And another thing I didn't know is that even this dream come true university life, it's just gonna last a few months. April 6th, that's the time the plane with the two presidents was shot down and the two presidents died and everything fell apart.
It is not like anything I've ever seen in 30 years as a reporter. It is, I think, the standard against which all future tragedies will be measured. For all up and down this road that leads north from the border, there is madness and horror beyond telling, beyond belief.
I found myself in Congo, where we fled as millions, and then became clear that there is no future there, so we pushed farther, and I found myself in a Malawi refugee camp, and with no hope of how I would connect with education, with a lot of pain of how many people we had lost. At the time, I didn't even know if my parents had survived or not. It was a very, very taunting and painful experience, to say the least. I had never lived in a tent. I actually had never seen a tent. I didn't even know a tent exists. You know, now I know that people actually grab tents for fun. You know, for us it was a nightmare. There is a time I was wondering why I survived at all, because it was very hard. You know, the whole process and the longer talk. Each day was painfully long. And I prayed a lot. I'm not proud of some prayers I prayed. I was harsh on God, I would say. You know, I thought God is just not caring at all, or is not everywhere, you know. I regret some of the words I said to God, but I'm sure God can take it. My hope, my prayers were answered through people, you know. From the time I was blessed to leave the camp to this date, every single prayer I prayed is always answered through people. And so I have discovered a different view of how this God we believe in works. It's one another, you know. So I came to realize that all of the harsh words I said to God, God was totally innocent. God had put everything in place for us to care for one another. He put in us love. He gives us resources, you know. And God counts on us. The well-being of my neighbor depends on me. And God designed it that way. So that's how we ended up with Watoto Read, you know. I am completely responding to that understanding that the resources those kids need are not going to be parachuted from heaven. They are within us, you know. They are with me. They don't have a voice. They are in a bush somewhere. They don't have food. They don't have health care. They don't have bathrooms. I realize that I can't wait anymore. So I figured I'm not rich, I don't have a lot of means, there's no way I can make a very big impact, but I'm better off because I connect to the education. So when I discovered that almost 70% of kids in refugee camps don't go to school, I found a window for me. I'm thinking, if we can convince all the good people to sacrifice and help us educate these kids, maybe they can connect to high school, maybe they can connect to college, maybe their future could look bright like mine now, you see. I don't cry in the shower anymore. Now I sing again because I feel like I'm now doing something about the pain I was feeling, you know.